wish you all a very good evening, students. I'm here again to teach you a lesson on English. Hope you all are fine. Today we will talk a little about the second lesson, that is the ransom of the Red Chief. The ransom of Red Chief. I had already sent you the text and I'm sure you must have got it. So whenever you listen to this video, I would suggest that you keep the textbook or the downloaded pages in front of you so that you can easily understand what I'm talking. Let's begin. I hope you all are fine. So let's begin here. This is a very funny story. It's a very funny story. It is about, I'll talk to you about the characters first. We have the hero. He was a boy of around 10 year old boy. He's just a kid. The word used for him is just a kid of 10 year old. Then there are two kidnappers. One is Bill Driscoll and the author, the narrator. We will also understand the setting of the story. The story is in Alabama, that we have already understood when you must have read the story. You have to find out from the Google map, because Alabama is a town or a township or a county, they call it as, in USA, that is United States of America. So the story, I just first explain to you the gist of the story, and then I will tell you to underline the new words. The narrator is talking and he talks like that. We are down south in Alabama, Bill Driscoll and myself, when suddenly they think about the kidnapping idea. The idea struck. So you will underline the words. The idea struck them. Use this phrase in your sentence. So this is a phrase where you can note it down. You sit with your pen and paper and you keep noting down. The first phrase you can write here is an idea struck. Now we will write it as an idea. Why? Because we have I there and I is a vowel, and so we have the word and before it. So an idea struck to them, and when they were not financially very well off, so they needed some money. They were falling short. They wanted to, now why did they need money? You know, they needed money because they wanted to buy some land in a place in Western Illinois. Illinois. Now they wanted to buy this land. And so to buy this land, they needed money. But this was a very bad idea. Basically, this is not the right idea. The whole story is very funny. We will understand as you go in detail, because today I'm going to explain to you only section one. And the section one is the introduction, that is from we were down south till we move down to the actual section one starts from the story one evening. If you can see the page of 24 and the line one evening, we drove in a buggy. And it goes on to the next page, that is page number 25, and it talks, it is still line number, as at last I fell into the troubled sleep and dreamed that I had been kidnapped and chained to the tree by a ferocious pirate with the red hair. Now the fun starts. No, the fun doesn't start still. This is the setting. So the story says that these two kidnappers were in Alabama, and they were not happy about their situation, and so they needed money, and so an idea struck them, and they got an idea. Oh, let's do something like that. So Bill and me here is the narrator. Who's the narrator? The author, O. Henry. So Bill and me had about $600. They had money. They had $600, but they needed how many more? They needed just 2,000 more. And if they got that, so six in plus 2, that is 6, 7, 8. So if they got $8,000 at hand, they would be able to buy some land in Western Illinois. Now the next line says, we figured that family love is strongest in semi-rural communities. So underline the word figure that. We figured that. Figured that here means we understood that. To figure out something is to understand something. Like if you are learning something on the computer, it's a new thing for you. So you will say, oh, I can't figure it out, ma'am. How is it supposed to be done? And then when you do it, and then you say, oh, yes, I figured it out. So figure out is another phrase. So here the two kidnappers, they're not still the kidnappers. They've thought of it. They got an idea of kidnapping. So here the two men, because they wanted to buy a land in Western Illinois, figured out that whom should we, now they had to decide for a victim, right? Whom to kidnap. So they did a survey. I'm sure you understand the meaning of the word survey. So they did a survey, and there they understood that in the semi-rural areas, that is not very high class area, not urban, I'm talking about the word rural. Rural is the opposite of urban, and so we are talking about a semi-rural area. Urban areas are developed areas, rural areas are village areas or the underdeveloped areas, undeveloped area. But this area which we are talking about is a semi-rural area. So they thought, they understood, figured out is, they surveyed, they went there, they observed the families over there, and they understood that the bond of the family, the mother, father, children, grandparents, they all have a very strong bond. You understand what is the meaning of a bond? They loved each other very much. So they understood that, okay, if we kidnap somebody from this area, if we kidnap a child, generally a child is kidnapped. So if we kidnap a child from this area and then we call up their parents, I'm sure you must have seen in the Hindi movies that if the wealthy man has a boy or a son or a daughter, what they do is they kidnap him, and then they will give a phone call. Hello, aapka beta mere paas hai. Something like that, this is getting into the climax of the story. Let's see what happens. So they thought of this climax. So they thought of the whole idea, and then they decided to kidnap a child from this area, Western Illinois. Because they figured out, I again use the word figured out, that family love was very strong in this area. And so they decided to go to an area, a small town in this place called the Summit. S-U-M-M-I-T, called the Summit. Now, this is, you can Google it on the map and find it out where exactly is the Summit in America, where is the place and all that. So the author is reading and talking. He's the narrator. We selected for a victim. Victim is the person here. It is a person. Otherwise, victim is the one who is going to be in trouble. The victim is the one who is in trouble. So here they decided. So here I can use another word instead of victim. Please, if you're sitting with your notebook, you can use for victim here. They had decided for their prey. P-R-E-Y, prey. You know, they attack the one whom they are going to attack on. Like the animals have a prey. So they decided on a victim. Now obviously they are not going to kidnap somebody, an average man's son, or a poor man's son. How is the poor man going to give them money? And they wanted money. So what they did is they decided to kidnap the only son of a man called, he was a very prominent, very famous man. Prominent is seen out of the whole crowd. Supposing there are 100 children standing and you are the smartest, so you become the prominent one, right? So he was a very famous and a prominent citizen, like a wealthy man, the Ambanis, or yeah, so he was something like that, a very famous businessman. and his name was Ebenezer Dorset. E-B-E-N-E-Z-E-R. He is a character. So we have three characters here. We talked about the four characters. We have the two kidnappers and we have the boy. We have not yet understood his name, and we have the father of the boy, whose name is Ebenezer Dorset. Okay, so Mr. Dorset was known for his wealth. So the phrase is here, known for his wealth. So if you have a pen and paper, please write it, underline the textbook, known for his wealth, which he made from, how did he become so wealthy? He made wealth. Which he made. Now, how can you make wealth? Wealth is not a chapati that you make it in the kitchen. So you will be confused. But that is a phrase, that is a style of saying. That's English. That's what you have to understand. So he made wealth. How did he make wealth? He was known for his wealth. He was very famous because he was a very healthy, wealthy man. So how did he make wealth? He made wealth by lending mortgage and making foreclosures. Now foreclosures is he gave land, if you turn the page to page number 28, you will understand. They have given the meaning of the word foreclosure and mortgage both. Here they read foreclosure as to take back a property that was bought with borrowed money because that money was not paid. Now, supposing you buy a land and you had borrowed some money to buy the land, but you have to repay the money to the person from whom you have borrowed. Now, you were not able to pay the money on time. Obviously, you're not going to be spared. The person will come and he is going to hold your neck, catch you hold from the neck. Here, something like that. So here, the foreclosure is to take back the property because you're not able to pay the money. You take back the property that was bought with from the borrowed money because you cannot pay the money. Okay, is not being paid back as per the conditions. Terms and conditions apply. Okay, then we understand that the next meaning is mortgage. What is mortgage here? Mortgage is a loan. It's all on page number 28 in the yellow box, words to know. Mortgage is a loan taken when we buy a property. Is a loan. I don't have money that I can buy a property. Property is land. Land is very costly nowadays, and so we should take care of the land. We should take care of Mother Earth. Lot of money needed. So what were we talking about? Is we were talking about mortgage. We were talking about mortgage is a loan you take from the bank. You take money from the bank, which you normally take to buy a land. So here the business of Ebenezer Dorset was that he used to give money to the people who wanted money to buy land and foreclosures. He had a son who was a 10-year-old boy. The kid was a boy of 10 years and he had freckles. Freckles, if you see the meaning in the dictionary, freckles is dotted skin, brown dotted skin. Now remember children, this area I am talking about is in USA. Now the people there are quite, fair, and so the dots on the freckles on the skin are very clearly seen. The kid was only 10 years old. He had, now there's a description of the boy, and he has freckles and his hair was bright red in color, bright red hair. Bill and me figured, again the word figured, that Ebenezer Dorset would agree to pay what, and obviously a father loves him so much, so he would agree to pay whatever money he wanted. And yes, so we were talking about the boy, the child of Ebenezer Dorset. The kid was 10 years and freckles, and they needed 2000 rupees only. they were basically not bad people. They were bad people, but then they could have asked for $10,000. I'm sorry, it's not rupees, it's dollars. So they could have asked for $10,000, but they were they needed only $2,000. But wait till the author says, but wait till I tell you what happened. Something happened. About 2 miles, now they go somewhere. About 2 miles from summit, now they are describing the area. Summit is the area we are talking about. So from 2 miles away from summit, there was a little mountain. There was a little tree-covered mountain. And on the rare slope of this mountain was a cave. What was there? There was a small cave there. There we stored provisions. Now underline the word provisions, and provisions here are articles which are of daily use. That is why the store which gives you provisions is also called, daily provisions is called provisional store. Now if you turn the page again on page number 28, it is given food, drink, other kinds of facilities, equipments and other things of daily use. So from 2 miles away, there was a summit, and away from the summit, there was a cave in a tree-covered mountain. On the rare slope, I'm sure you know the meaning of the word rare. On the rare slope of the mountain was a cave, and there these kidnappers, remember the narrator is a kidnapper himself, so he's talking. So he says, there we stored all our important needed items. That was our home in a cave. That's funny. Obviously such people do not are not fit to live in a society, and they are all very bad people. Children, you should never move out alone. So from here we talk about section one. The story goes like that. So what they do is, one evening when they decide to kidnap somebody, they take a buggy. Buggy is a horse cart of a ghoda gadi kind of a thing, you know. They take a buggy and they pass through the house of Dorset. And the kid was playing, how you all play out in the streets, but not now, you are not supposed to go out. So the kid was playing out in the street, and he was throwing stones at the, there was a small kitten playing, cat's baby, kitten, I'm sure you know the meaning. So there was a small baby cat kitten playing out on the opposite side of the fence. And so he was playing, that's not the right kind of play. You know, he was throwing rock, small pieces of stones or small rocks at the kitten. It was fun for him, but that's not right. He might injure the boy, injure the kitten. So if boys, you, boys and girls, should not harm animals. Should not harm animals. This is not the right kind of play. But anyways, the story says that he was a mischievous boy, and we will understand. So this is explaining to you the character of this child. And still they have not given the name of that boy. That boy was, we don't know his name. We will name him afterwards. Okay, so one evening we drove in a buggy past old Dorset's house, and the kid was in the street throwing rocks at the kitten on the opposite fence. "Hey," says Bill, "would you like to have some candy?" Candy? Yeah, see, this is called temptation. He was a kidnapper. So both the kidnappers, they never take food or chocolates or tempt by getting anything from the strangers. If a stranger says, "Come on, take this now and come with me," they will kidnap you. Children of this age, this is a very nice lesson for y'all. I'm sure y'all are very smart. Y'all are also very smart. We cannot accept things from the kidnapper, from the strangers like that. But he was only a 10-year-old boy, 10-year, maybe in the 5th standard. How old are you? 10 years. So when the boy is asked that, "Hey Bill, would you like to have," say, then Bill asks, hey boy, "would you like to have some candy?" So the boy was a bit upset, and he took a brick and he threw at Bill's head, That boy put up a fight. Underline the word put up a fight. That boy put up a fight, but eventually we got them into the buggy. Now I'm going to explain to you in indirect speech. He was put, he was picked up and pushed in the buggy, and they drove to the cave. Now it was not a horse buggy. Well, that's not very sure. The photograph of the buggy is not given over here. So when it was dark, they went back to the village because they had hired. Hired means they had taken on rent. How we take a hire cycle on hire and then move, drive the cycle, ride on the bicycle the whole day, and then again return it back to the shopkeeper, had renter from whom you have taken it on rent. In the same way, they had hired the buggy. Buggy is the cart. Just for this purpose, and so he had to return it back. While the narrator was there, Bill was examining and treating the scratches. Now, where did he get the scratches from? How did he injure himself? Examining, like how the doctor examines you. So he was hurt, you know. So he was observing. He was observing. Oh my God, I've got so much of hurt. So he was doing that. And then he had bruises, he has cuts and bruises and scratches on all his face and legs and all that. There was fire burning in the cave. Obviously, it was a cave. There was no electricity, and so there was a fire burning in the cave. And the boy was sitting next to the fire with two buzzard tail feathers. Buzzard. Very odd kind of... Yeah, so we were talking about the two buzzard tail feathers he had stuck in his hair, and he points a stick at me and says, who? The boy. The boy tells the narrator, ha, cursed pale face, do you dare to enter Red Chief's camp? So the boy, whose name we will understand later, it is mentioned over here, is Johnny. The boy had his own imaginations. If you have seen the movie Baby's Day Out, the baby has his own imaginations. In the same way, this boy has his own imaginations, and he imagined that it was a camp. This place, this cave, was his own territory, and he was the chief. He was the sardar. He was the head of that area, and he named himself as Red Chief. And so he calls the kidnapper, the narrator, ha, cursed, the pale face. He was a pale face thing. So, pale face, do you dare to enter Red Chief's camp? How dare you come inside my camp? How dare you enter into my camp? So, this is how he was playing. He's all right now, says Bill. We are playing Indian. I am the old Hank. I am the old Hank, Red Chief's captive. And I am to be scalped by daybreak. Ouch! The kid can kick hard. Now, how did this happen? What's this? Who is talking this and what is happening? He is all right now, says Bill. They are talking, the two kidnappers are talking between themselves, and they say, he is all right now. They are talking about the boy. Thank God he is all right. We are playing Indian. Then he says, I am old Hank, Red Chief's captive. He says, I am the old Hank. I am the captive. Now, the kidnappers, it is so funny over here that the victim is the one, or the one who is kidnapped. Here, the boy is the victim. And another word who is captured, a person who is captured or a child who is captured, I'm sure you have learnt it in the lower classes, he's a captive. But here, the situation is something very different. The kidnappers feel as if they are the captives. It's an opposite situation, because the victim, actual victim, that is a boy, he is so confident. It looks like as if he has kidnapped the two men who are actually the kidnappers. And they are the victims and he is the kidnapper. It's a topsy-turvy change of role, complete change of role. You become I and I become you. You become the teacher and I become the student. You remember, we do it in the class, change of roles. So here it is, there is a change of roles. So they say, ouch, the kid can hit hard. So the kid is hitting them, pulling their hair and pushing them and beating them. And he enjoys all the situation. The boy was very happy. The fun of the camp, the boy was very happy. And the fun of camping out had made him forget that the boy was really happy, and the whole thing was so very exciting for him that he felt that I'm so great, and I have kidnapped somebody, and I am the kidnapper, and they are the captive. These two are the captives, and then we will see how the story goes on. So I'm not going to do too much about it now. I'm sure you will read the story. The section one is a very lengthy one. It goes on, as I told you in the between. I told you in the beginning that it goes on till the word ferocious. So what homework I'm going to give you students now is, you will again read section one till the end of the section, and I would love if somebody reads it. Anybody, one of you can read the whole thing, understand the story by yourself, and send me the explanation, like the way I have sent you my video. I would love to observe, because I know you all are smart kids, so you become the teacher and teach me the lesson. I'm sure we are going to enjoy the story as it goes on. So we stop over here, and very happy to be back with you students. Take care of yourself. Love you. God bless you. Bye.